Right, I kept the title from the program. Doesn't mean I'm going to talk about what I said I would. Let's see, does this work?
Oh,
maybe
the
whatever. I'll use
it.
It's okay. I want to do something a bit more with a philosophical aspect. Okay. And I want to start out with a few quotes that I found in this. Well, it's a summary of a debate in 2008, a plenary debate, quantum effects in biology, trivial or not. And here are a few quotes that I liked. Paul Davies, who's here, said, "What is trivial and what is non-trivial is a non-trivial topic." And I'm, it's hard to top that one. But I think it's a good point. Hans Fraunfelder said, "We need experiments to answer the question, but first we have to find out what the real question is, and we haven't done that yet." And I slightly agree with that one, too. Anton Zeilinger said, "What is called for is something like Bell's theorem." Now, I agree that that would be absolutely awesome. Sergei Bezrukov said, "Quantum mechanics, as of this moment, hasn't provided any qualitatively new insights into the mechanics studied by biological physics." Now, this might be slightly outdated by now. So 2008, that's 4 years ago. But it's something it would be great to discuss. Now, another one from Paul Davies. "To suppose that life hasn't discovered the awesome information processing power that quantum mechanics provides seems extraordinary hubris." Now, this is a bit of my lifeline, okay, because I'm going to talk about information and quantum information. And I put these quotes up not as some kind of gospel, but I take them as guidelines to point out a few things I've done in the last years to at least try to address some of these points. So if I ask quantum biology, what does count as quantum biology and what does not count? And what I put up here might be something we can continue over dinner. So for me, asking what the real question is, if I think of quantum biology as, well, there's some input, and you know, we've had examples of photosynthesis or magnetic reception, some input, and then there's a black box where we think there might be something quantum going on in this biological system. That would be the prerequisite. And then if, on the other side of this black box, so on the other side of the chromatin or the other side of the DNA, the output is something classical, something macroscopic, and it's unmediated, so there's not a lot of intermediate steps that eventually get you over the quantum classical barrier, and then you go all the way to evolution or whatever it might be. So if this is a direct connection, then I think it counts as quantum biology. So in this sense, one might be able to think of some of the phenomena we're looking at. Do they actually count? So, and what we're interested in is this black box. Now, this is sort of a communication diagram, right? You have some input, a message is being processed, and then you have some output on the other side. Now, for physicists, what is in here, where it could really be in communication, it would be the message, is encrypted, it is then compressed, and at the other side it's decompressed, decrypted, and it comes out. This kind of data compression for physicists is really a way of making a theory. So if on the left-hand side you have data coming from planetary motions, and on the right-hand side you want to predict what the planetary motions are going to be next month, then in between, if you're really clever, you take Newton's theory of gravity, maybe with a few corrections, and that is the data compression you're really doing. Now, if the data compression we need in here to have some quantum element, then I think we're in good shape. Talk about quantum biology. So that's my way of thinking about it. And this is where information theory is going to come in. Okay. So let's boil it down to something really simple, which is information processing in a time sequence. So here's a time sequence. It's my favorite kind of time sequence because it's just bits. It's easy. But you can think of this as data from any sort of system. These could be, you know, these could be DNA. It could be DNA data. It could be conformation of a protein, whatever is your favorite system. Now, I think of a computation in such a time sequence, for example, in this form. I take the first symbol, it's a 0, the next one is a 1, and let's say The third one is just the AND gate, taking the two first bits in. So what is an AND gate? It's a logical operation. It's really like a multiplication. You take one bit, you take another bit, you multiply them, and you get out the result. So that's a logical operation. It's a computation. And you can think of something like that happening in a time sequence. This is just one example. But really, we're talking about correlations in this time sequence. And that is a kind of information processing we can think of. Is that happening in a biological system? Is a protein remembering the configuration it's just had a minute ago or 2 minutes ago? Okay. And now this is all classical. But there's a very good theory that can deal with these things and ask, well, how much information processing is really going on in such a time sequence? And it's been developed by Cosmo Chalesi and Jim Crutchfield. And it's called Epsilon Machines. And what it does, it takes in a time sequence. And it just looks at strings and asks, well, what's the probability of the next symbol being 0 or 1? Now, if this probability is always a half, then you don't have to worry about the past, right? It doesn't matter for your prediction for what's happening next. But if there is actually a difference in the probability of what's happening next, then it's good if you remember what did happen so you can predict properly what the next configuration is going to be or when the next mutation is going to happen. Now, in this kind of information theoretic treatment, it's really based on statistics and sufficient statistic in particular, you then group all the kinds of things you've seen before that lead you to the same prediction for the future into equivalence classes. Okay. So you don't distinguish between things that give you the same prediction for what's happening in the next second, let's say. And you group them all together, and then you get, if you're lucky, and that's usually just a finite number of states. Now, these finite number of states, you can then say, well, those states really characterize what the system is doing. And some of these states might be very unlikely, some of them might be very likely. And over this probability distribution, you can compute an entropy. Now, I haven't put very much math into this talk, so I try to give you the concepts, but if there's anything really unclear, just interrupt me. So if we have probabilities over these states, so you know certain configurations are very unlikely, let's say, we get an entropy, and this entropy counts as a complexity. So the more states we have, and the more uniform the distribution over these states is, the more complex is the system, the more kinds of behaviors we have in that system, the more information processing is going on in the system. Okay? Now, it's these kinds of ideas that we took and expanded them to quantum mechanics. And so here's one example of, if you thought about this process of the AND process, which I call it, and you took this sequence and you put it through the process of finding out the number of states, what you would find is you'd find five states, and I've labeled them A, B, C, D, E, and you'd find out what the probabilities are for the next symbols. And this is the, if you like, the closed form expression of the kind of information processing going on in your system. And this really contains all the information you can possibly know about the system. Any noise there is in it, you don't ignore it, you just don't pretend you can model it. You just model it as noise. Okay. So this is part of work I did with Janet Anders, who's in the audience. Now, to generalize this to quantum mechanics, we then asked, well, what if I allow for this information processing to be based on some quantum mechanical, well, on some quantum physics, really? So for the moment, it's just my perspective. If I want to predict that system, I want to find out what's the next configuration the protein could have, and I can use a quantum computer to figure it out. Is it going to be easier for me to use the quantum computer or the classical computer? Now, if the answer for me is, well, actually, I'll be faster, and it'll cost me less money if I use a quantum computer, then it doesn't prove anything about the system using a quantum computer, obviously. But it might be a hint that maybe this would be a place to look at for quantum information processing. That's the underlying idea. And so what we did is we looked at this formalism for these classical states. We extended them to quantum states. And I'm not going into how exactly that's being done. That's all explained in this paper with Milegu, Elisabeth Ripa, and Vlatko Vedral. And what we found is when you just transform these classical states into quantum states, so you allow for quantum information processing to be happening inside of that system, what you get is you get a lower complexity. Now, you get the same behavior. The system, because the output data are the same, the classical bits, but the information processing that's happening inside is less or cheaper or with fewer resources, if you like. So here is an example where if we take this AND process, which is a, you know, a totally made-up thing, but we need, on average, 2.2 bits. So we need a computer with 2.2 classical bits to simulate this process. If we had a quantum computer, we'd only need, well, let's take this p equals 0 case, 2.1. So we need fewer resources. And then p is actually is a parameter for noise. So if you allow this process to have a slight amount of noise, so it's not a perfect operation, and we don't expect natural systems to be perfect, but they're noisy, as we've heard several times before. So this kind of noise, we can model that easily. And it turns out that for a quantum computer, it could deal very much more efficiently with noise than a classical computer could. It just uses up less resources for something that's noisy anyways. Okay. So we've established that it's always the case that quantum mechanically you use less or equal to what you use classically. Now, what are we going to do with this? Well, the first thing we wanted to know is, can we do even better? Can we compress it even more, the amount of quantum information processing that we have to do to predict our system at hand? And it turns out, no. So that's work that's unpublished, about to be published with Milegu and Alex Monroz. And the consequence is this. Well, if you like, you count the number of bits in your computer, you can't do better classically or quantum mechanically, but it's an argument of scale. If you simulate the same system 10 times, 20 times, 100 times, then in that scaling up the system, you win. You always win quantum mechanically. And since nature is very good at dealing with noise and at being very resourceful, you know, it's just another hint that maybe it might actually be doing something quantum mechanically when it can. Okay, now I actually wanted to skip this slide because it's very speculative. But here's something, again, another aspect of physics which we might be able to harness to look for quantum mechanical effects. And it's the following thing. It addresses the question of qualitatively new insights. Namely, what we found is when you take a time sequence and you ask, how much information processing do you need to do to regenerate the information that is in that time sequence? So the correlations that are in there, if you wanted to compute them, how difficult would it be? That was the CMU, which I've had before. This CMU, the complexity is the difficulty of regenerating the correlations that you're seeing in your data. Now, if we take this, and then something which I'll only throw at you without really explaining what it is, it's what is the information content in the time sequence itself. Now, these are two different things, right? It takes you some resources to generate something, but then what is actually in what you've generated, the amount of information in there, might not be the same quantities because you've used resources that in the end of the day you have to throw away. So it's a question of efficiency. How much does it take you to generate some correlations versus how much correlations have you actually generated? And this is very similar to a thermodynamic cost. How much energy do you put into something versus actually generating free energy that you can use up at the end of the day? And it turns out there's a very simple argument in going from the information content of a time sequence to a thermodynamic cost of generating the correlations in that time sequence. And this kind of efficiency then tells you something about basically how much heat is generated when that system is you like, generating its own behavior, generating its own correlations. Okay. Now that, again, is very abstract, because I can't tell you concretely how you would do an experiment, but people have measured exactly this kind of cost. You might have heard the term KT log 2, which is the amount of heat that's generated when you erase one bit. Okay, but here, this is the amount of heat that's generated when you erase something more complicated. And that has been measured experimentally. So to me, so the next slide is going to be crucial to tell you why I think this might be interesting. So up here, we have, for an example, again, which is explained in this paper, we have the classical resources you need to generate the correlations in this particular example. We have the quantum mechanical resources you need to generate it. And the red curve, the lowest curve, is the actual information content in there. Now, if you don't want to break or violate the second law of thermodynamics, you can't use fewer resources to generate, you know, more correlations than you've actually put in your efforts. So, but anything beyond that is lost. Anything beyond that, you're wasting. So anything beyond that is going to go up in heat in some way or form. So, you know, this is my last speculation for this talk. Is there a way to measure heat that you, that would make it possible to distinguish between quantum and classical information processing in a system? I should cut this out of the video. Okay. So my summary, first thing, my way of thinking about what quantum biology is as a communication process. So if in the middle you have something quantum mechanical and the output is classical, then I think we can fairly say it's quantum biology. Processing efficiency as a thermodynamic signature of quantum biology is my speculative element in this talk. And I want to end on another quote from the same panel discussion. I think a better definition of what is non-trivial in quantum biology is something that would convince a biologist that they need to learn quantum mechanics. And thank you very much.